we've already said we are talking about harmony in the family. We've looked at harmony in the human being. We started with trust and respect in the feelings in relationship. And now we'll move on to the other feelings. So when I see that the other, like me, also has a natural acceptance to make me happy and prosperous, regardless of my own competence, then I get assured of the other, and that is trust. With this feeling of assurance or trust on intention, when I'm able to rightly evaluate the other's competence as well as my own competence, which is respect, then I'm able to define my complementarity with the other. And this way, I'm able to accept the other as my relative. Now, this feeling of being related to the other, accepting the other as my relative, that the other is like me, this feeling is called affection. So this feeling of affection is the feeling of accepting the other as my relative. And we can see this in a lot of relationships. We can see it in the parent-child relationship. The child has a feeling of affection for the parent. The parent has a feeling of affection for the child. We can also see it among siblings. We can see it among friends. We can see it between teachers and students. We can see it between husband and wife. And in fact, for any relationship, it is a naturally acceptable feeling and it is desired. Now, when one has the feeling of affection, one takes on the responsibility and commitment for mutual fulfillment in the relationship. So for this fulfillment of any relationship, the feeling of affection is essential. And this is really necessary. We can see it very plainly for children. Studies have shown that babies and small children who are in orphanages, even though they may be provided the best of food, you know, the most nutritious food, many of these children, they don't grow very well. They don't develop very well. But when they are adopted by a loving family, then they sort of blossom. They not only develop better, they laugh more, they, you know, improve in their weight and so on. So we can see that this feeling of affection, how much of a difference it makes. And it's not just for children. It is true for even the elderly people, even the, you know, anybody in any kind of relationship. So when there is a lack of affection, then we see opposition. Then we see jealousy. So these are indicating that that feeling of affection is not there. So this we see, for example, commonly seen in sibling rivalry. That is some feeling of opposition between children within the same family. Or a feeling of opposition when, you know, say you, a new baby is born in the house. Then the older child a lot of times has this feeling of opposition for the new baby. And if we look at why this happens, then we can see that a lot of times when the new baby is born, the mother is, you know, despite all good intentions and trying to do so many things, the mother has to devote a lot of time to the new baby. And in that process, a lot of times the older child gets little neglected. And occasionally, you know, the mother might scold the child or ask the child to leave the room when she's taking care of the baby and so on. And this leads to a feeling of opposition for the baby. The child will not have this feeling of opposition for the mother, but has this feeling of opposition for what in the child's eye is the object of the mother's affection. So, and this can be, you know, gotten rid of very easily by the mother asking the child to be involved in the baby's care. So when the mother is, you know, changing the baby's nappies, she can ask the older child to bring the nappy and, you know, encourage him to help out in these things so that he also feels a part, he or she feels a part of the whole family. So we can see that, this is a very necessary feeling in all relationships. Then we can go on to the feeling of care and the feeling of guidance. While the feeling of care is a feeling of responsibility towards the body of my relative, the feeling of guidance is the feeling of responsibility towards the self of my relative. So when I can see that I have this feeling of responsibility, I have accepted the other as my relative and I want to mutually fulfill that relationship, then I naturally feel responsible and take on this responsibility towards the body and the self of my relative. So the responsibility and commitment to nurture and protect the body of my relative, that is the feeling of care. And the responsibility and commitment for providing the right understanding and the right feeling in the self of my relative, that is the feeling of guidance. So there is a difference between the two. While care is largely or mostly, it is focused on the taking care of the body of my relative, guidance is focused on providing the right understanding and the right feeling to the self of the relative. And you, this also, you know, if you look at the feeling of care, parents, you can see this feeling of care for the child. You will see it in both mothers and fathers. Like, for instance, you know, in the mother, when baby is tiny, or even once the baby is older, the mother will give up on her sleep, might give up on her food to make sure that there is enough food for the child, make sure that the baby gets fed in time. And she will put the baby's needs before hers. Baby's body needs will be before hers. Now, in the case of the father also, the father will help to nurture, to protect the child's body. So we can see the feeling of care very often in parents for their children. And this is not just important for small children. It is also important for elder people, older people who may need some help with taking care of the body. Say, you know, the elderly who perhaps are not able to take a bath by themselves, or they are not able to eat by themselves. They may need some help with all of this. If we see this feeling of care, this is the only feeling for which physical facility is required. For fulfilling all other feelings, physical facility has no role, or at least, you know, if at most it has a symbolic role. So when we have feeling of affection, we take care of the relative's body willingly, because we have this affection. But if we are feeling like we are having to sacrifice something, or if we are feeling that this is a burden, this is like drudgery, then somewhere we don't have this, you know, feeling of affection. So we have to look at that. If we feel like we are sacrificing something for somebody, then we have not yet ensured that feeling of affection within ourselves. So that's why care, that feeling of care, doesn't come as naturally. If you look at guidance, guidance, like we said, has to do with the self. So once we are aware that the human being is not just the body, that the human being is self plus body, then we naturally become responsible towards the self of the relative. So we see this very frequently in families. You know, we guide the child, we help the child to learn, to walk, to speak, to learn different things. We answer their questions. And when they get older, we provide them a lot of guidance in education. You know, teachers provide guidance to the students when they are in college. They counsel them for having a successful life, and so on. So there is once we are clear of the human being self and body, we take care of both these feelings, the feeling of care and the feeling of guidance. We take care, or we give importance to both of these. And like we mentioned, care and guidance are a natural outcome of affection. So we need to look at are we ensuring both care as well as guidance? Or are we mostly focusing on care in our day-to-day life? For example, when we are taking care of the body, like when we are feeding the child, are we concerned about both the body as well as the self? Like, you know, again, I'll take this example of mother and child because this is a very commonly seen example. Lot of mothers have having the best intention for the child. They want the child to grow well. They want the child to have the food that is nutritious for them and so on. So a lot of times what they do is they mix a bowl of food and then they try to make sure that the baby has the entire bowl. And a lot of times what happens is that the baby sort of feels full after, say, you know, 3/4 of the bowl or maybe when 2-3 spoons are left. But mothers will try to force feed that last bit so that they finish the bowl that has been made for them. And many a time the child will sort of cry, the child will move the face away, close the mouth and do all kinds of things. And yet we, you know, somehow make them open their mouth and put the food, force the food in. So here we need to just see for a moment, you know, yes, we are taking care of the body of the baby or the child, but are we also taking care of the self? Are we able to see that we are making the self also unhappy in that process? So we are not taking care of the self, we are only focusing on the body. So, you know, a lot of times you might feel that if it's a small baby, the baby won't know how much to take. But if we go back to when the baby was a newborn baby and the baby was breastfeeding, when a baby is breastfeeding, it's not the mother who decides how much the baby needs. The baby decides how much. The mother just feeds the baby, and when the baby is full, the baby stops feeding and that's it. So if the baby can decide at the age when he's newborn, then the baby can also make out when the baby is 8, 9 months, 10 months, 2 years, 3 years, and so on. So we'll take your reflection on this. What do you feel about this taking care of or ensuring this feeling of care and guidance? Do we ensure both care as well as guidance? Or are we mostly focused on care? What do you feel? What are your reflections about this? So if parents have the right understanding of the harmony and they are living in harmony, then the child can also learn from them. The child can also have this guidance from them. But if we are more focused on the body, then we tend to pay more attention to the feeling of care. And a lot of times that feeling of guidance or that taking care of the self part, that gets left out. So that is something that we can focus on. And if the parents don't have the right understanding, they are not able to provide this right understanding and right feeling to the child, then the child just acquires the same preconditionings that the parents have. And these have not been verified. So these preconditionings could be right or wrong for the child. So without, you know, really verifying them, the child grows up, maybe leaves the family and has this whole set of preconditionings.
Maybe in the meantime, Didi, when people are
raising hand.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can take we can take a question.
Dr. Suresha. Dr. Suresha.
Yeah. Good morning, sir. Can morning. You hear me?
Yes, yes, we can hear you. Go ahead, please.
The very important takeaway from this workshop is about the importance of self, madam. That's what I learned. Mm-hmm. And also about the subconscious mind. Mm-hmm. The role of subconscious mind and how to tune that. In fact, I'm also practicing about that. And again, the relationship, understanding, and all those things. In fact, These are the things we are having, especially trust. Even as a principal, I trust my people because I've mm-hmm. got a very good team under me where we are working the, for the growth of institute. So that already I'm practicing it. Mm-hmm. So this is what I wanted to say about that.
Very nice, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very
nice.
Much.
Nice. Thank you. So yeah, very nice. We can see in the reflection that most people are able to ensure both care and guidance.
Didi, Dr. Deepa has made some comment. Huh. She has raised her hand. Dr. Huh. Deepa Jinayar.
Hello, sir. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
Actually, this is very, really interesting session, especially when we think about not the actual domestic family, when we think the students and the entire academic fraternity as our family, especially with our students. Mm-hmm. The definition is totally somewhat inspiring to me because when we care in the sense feeling of responsibility towards body of my relative in the sense towards my students, mm-hmm. We the teachers usually think that we have to teach them anyway. We force them to study. You have to mm-hmm. cover this much modules. You need to prepare for the exam. You need to get good marks. Mm-hmm. That means we are really caring only, but with respect to guidance, definitely we are not going much into deeper guidance part. We are not understanding. We are not trying to understand why these students are not showing that much. Some of them, they are not that much interested towards their studies. That part we need to work more on that guidance part rather than this caring part, I suppose.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am, for that sharing. Yeah, I think, you know, both are important. Care and guidance, both are important. But then we have been looking at ourselves as the body for so long that I think, you know, our whole perspective is that. So our focus gets more on the body. But that's the, you know, beauty of self-exploration, that we can evolve to become better human beings and we can be more resolved within ourselves with these kind of things. True. So we'll go ahead to the next feeling. One moment. So we move on to the feeling of reverence. The feeling of reverence is the feeling of acceptance for excellence. So what is this excellence? Excellence or Shreshtha is the completeness of right understanding. So which means that it will be a state of continuous happiness or harmony. Because if a person has the right understanding and he is living in harmony, regardless of the situation around, then that is a state of continuous happiness. This happiness or this harmony will be in continuity without a break. So this is definite. This is absolute and it has continuity. If we look at, you know, working for excellence versus competing with each other, that's not the same. Like when we tell students that, or we tell our children that they must come first in class. Now that is a feeling of competition. But a feeling of working for excellence can be if we ask our child or if we ask the student to try and understand everything that is being taught in the class. So we can work for excellence or we can be making effort for competition. When we are working for excellence, we try to bring the other up to our level or to the level of excellence. But in competition, we actually hinder the other person from reaching our level. So there is a very big difference between competition and excellence. So we'll take a reflection here. What is naturally acceptable to you? To work for excellence or to compete with the other person? Yeah. So if you can answer this reflection, what is naturally acceptable to you? To work for excellence or to compete with the other person? there was a very nice video that somebody had shared on WhatsApp about a bunch of children who were handicapped, the special children who, you know, were going to be running in a race. And they showed all these participants, children with Down syndrome and some other children. They were all able to run, but they had some sort of handicap. They were all in waiting for the start to run. And the parents were in the stands who were encouraging and sort of asking the child to run fast and all those things. And when the race began, these children started running. And the child who was ahead of the others stumbled and fell down. So normally what would happen in a race, you know, if somebody falls, the others will keep going and there will be a first, second, third declared in the race. But these children, the child that came up to this child who had fallen next stopped and tried to see if the child was hurt, helped the child to, you know, get up. And all these other children who were also running in the race, they also huddled, came, and they sort of tried to get this child up. And they all held hands together, and then they ran together to the finish line. So now you can see here that these children, they have probably not yet been preconditioned by society. So you can see that it is naturally acceptable to them to help each other rather than to compete and come first. So if we could have that kind of environment, then, you know, sporting races and all is a different issue. But then when we take it to a limit, this working for competition, then it obviously, you know, we can see everybody's reflection also shows that it is naturally acceptable to us to work for excellence rather than to compete with one another.
Maybe we can take one question. Dr. Samira Reddy has been raising her hand for some time. Dr. Samira?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, Dr. Venkatesh? Fine, I think we are not able to reach them. Fine, you can continue.
Yeah, we'll continue. So if we look at the difference between making effort for excellence and making effort for competition. So when we make effort for excellence, then we are trying to help the other. We can see the complementarity between one another. But when we are competing with one another, then the other is not in the picture. It's only me and I want to do better than the other. So I am different. I want to be more than the other. When we work for excellence, our feelings are based on right understanding. So these feelings are definite. They are unchanging. And it's an unconditional relationship. There are no conditions around it. But when we are working for competition, these feelings are based on some preconditioning. So because it's an assumption, it is indefinite. It can keep changing. And that's why there is a condition on the relationship. So, you know, at some point we put some condition, and when such and such condition is met, we have the relationship with the person. Other times we don't. So when we work for excellence, we try to nurture the other. But when we are making effort for competition, we may or may not nurture. In fact, a lot of times we tend to exploit the other so that we come ahead first. While in excellence, we try to help the other to come to our level. In competition, we stop the other from coming to our level. And we make an effort to accentuate this difference. We dominate, we manipulate, and so on. And while excellence is an absolute goal, there is a definite completion point. Competition is relative, so there is no definite completion point here. So I hope this is kind of clear, the difference between excellence and competition. we can maybe take a couple of questions.
We can also note that every child in the class can become excellent. But yes. Only one child can come first.
First, exactly.
And the moment you make that as the target, you know, like coming first as a target, you just see what kind of environment is there in the class, right? Yes. Every child is opponent of the other, because if one child comes first, the other is not going to come first. So we are disturbing the whole harmony in the class. But when we are trying for excellence, and if you try to motivate for competition, then you can see, you know, what kind of environment is there in the institute. But when you try to work for excellence, we are all complementary. So probably, you know, we can also note this. Yeah.
True. We can see that, you know, every child has the desire for excellence. So, and we can also appreciate that every child has the potential for excellence based on what we have gone through previously with trust and respect. So we can see that everybody desires to reach there. Everybody has the potential for it. But it is just that we have to help them improve their competence. So if we see that, then that environment can change. That feeling for each other, you know, a negative kind of feeling for each other will change. Yeah. So, any questions?
We can take one question, Didi. Dr. Surekha is there. Dr. Surekha.
Yeah, please, ma'am. Go ahead.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Very good morning, madam. Yeah, very excited about care and guidance. I never thought they are too different. I used to feel caring is through self. But you are given a brief explanations. The caring is through body, and the other one, the guidance is through self. So it has given a clear picture, madam. So thank you very much for that. And you are giving an excellent presentation about self and body. So which is very much essential for the day, madam. Hello.
Ma'am. You are audible, ma'am. Yeah. You are audible.
Yes.
Very well said, madam.
Thank you.
Wanted to say only those things, madam. Thank you very much.
Anybody has any questions regarding the content that we've covered today?
Yeah. Dr. Shashidhar, please ask questions regarding the content that is being proposed right now. So, Dr. Shashidhar, any question?
We would love to have your comments also, but because of shortage of time, we'll focus on the questions on the content, and when there's time, we'll do the comments.
Okay, ma'am. I think we can proceed. Or yeah. Dr. Appa Sabha. Okay, we can take one question at most. Dr. Gurunath. Probably we are not able to reach them. Okay, Dr.
There
Gurunath.
There might be some problem with the mic. Hello. I think maybe.
Are you hearing me, ma'am?
Yes. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Madam, my question about the guidance, caring, and this part. Usually I used to teach my student physics. Maximum, because in first year, their activity by seeing their activity, and then I used to guide them in which direction they should move. But I'm maximum focusing on their mistakes. Then I found that by hearing you that maine 18 saal guzar di bachchon ki galtiyan dhoondte kaash ye class mujhe pehle milta shayad mera teaching out.
Nice comment, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. But I think, you know, whenever we get this, I think we can all incorporate it in our lives and sort of, you know, I feel it's never too late to start. Better late than never.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. So I think we'll go ahead, Kumar Bhaiya. So we'll go on to the feelings of glory and gratitude. The feeling of glory or Gaurav, that is the feeling for those who have made effort for excellence. Gratitude or Kritagyata is the feeling for those who have made effort for my excellence. So there's a little bit of difference here, and we'll elaborate on this. So we naturally have the feeling of glory or gaurav for those who are making some effort for excellence. And when we make effort for excellence, as teachers, when we make some effort towards excellence, we can be sure that students will also notice this, and it will be naturally acceptable to them to have this feeling for us. So when we have this doubt about how to motivate the students, I think, this is one point to keep in mind, that when we make effort for excellence, it will reflect in our behavior, and that will provide the students with it will be naturally acceptable for the students to have this feeling for us. And then slowly, with the communication opening up, once the trust is assured, then the student gets motivated and tries to be the same way. If we look at the feeling of gratitude, this feeling is the feeling that I have for all those who have helped me in any way in my effort to achieve excellence. For example, we see it very commonly that, most of us have a lot of gratitude for our parents. They've brought us up with affection. They've provided us with physical facility. They've helped us along at each point in our life. And if we go beyond this, we can also see gratitude for a lot of other things in life. A lot has been done for us by various people in life. And, we may or may not be aware of it all the time. But if we really start exploring that, we can see that a lot of people have helped us out in our life. If we look at people helping us in our life, when it comes to physical facility, we find that this feeling of gratitude stays for a longer time when the effort is made for guidance of the self rather than for physical facility. So like everything else that is material, when it comes to physical facility, which is at the level of body, we may not have this feeling in continuity. It comes and goes. So if we are only participating at the level of physical facility for others, and we are sort of expecting this feeling of gratitude to be there for us, it may be short-lived. It may be there for a very short time. So like I mentioned, this feeling of gratitude is seen not only in the family, but outside the family also. So for example, students have this feeling of gratitude for their teachers. I mean, all of us we have all taught and we have sort of advanced to this age in life. And yet many of us, if we go back and think, might remember so many teachers who guided us well during our school time, college time, and so on. So we have this feeling of gratitude towards our teachers. Then even if we look at other relationships that we have that we may not even be aware of, like yesterday we were talking of drinking a glass of milk and how many people may be involved in bringing that glass of milk to us. So small things like this also, there are so many people involved. And so do we have this feeling of gratitude in this lockdown period? Do we have this feeling of gratitude that we have enough to eat every day? So like this, we can see that, this feeling of gratitude can be there for a lot of things. Now, when sometimes what happens is when people are doing things for us, they are not able to do things for us despite the best of intention. So they do some things, but in our mind, some things have not been done. So do we tend to have gratitude for everything they have done? Or do we focus more on what was not done? So we'll be your reflection on this. Check whether you have a feeling of gratitude, feeling of being related to all. It is the complete value. It all starts with identifying that one is related to the other human being, that is affection. And then it slowly expands. This feeling of being related slowly expands to all human beings. And then to not just human beings, but to each and every unit in nature, human beings as well as other units. And what are these other units? We will be talking about later today when we talk about harmony in nature. So when we have this feeling of being related, not just to all human beings, but to all units in nature, that is what is love. And this feeling of love is expressed in the form of kindness or daya, beneficence or kripa, and compassion or karuna. So I'll just briefly mention what we mean by these terms. So kindness is to provide a resource that the other needs, but for which he doesn't have the competence. So the other person needs it, but doesn't have the competence. So if we provide that, that is an act of kindness. So this, what we may be providing, may be in the it may be in the form of fulfillment in relationship, or it may be right understanding.
Didi, your voice is breaking sometimes.
Kripa is to... Oho.
Now? You can repeat the sentences. Yeah, your voice is breaking sometimes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, feeling of love can be expressed in the form of kindness, fulfill that relationship, and then to evaluate the relationship, make sure that whatever feelings I have ensured in me have reached to the other, so that we can see that it leads to mutual happiness. And this justice, once we have it within the family, then from the family, we can extend it to a larger and larger circle till we get to the world family, so that we have an undivided society. So that is the whole aim for the relationship that we have in among human beings. And I think we have come to the end of the time.